Good afternoon. Welcome to I'm Nini. Today's boss, and welcome to 2017 Hong Kong Open Data Day Hackathon. For those who didn't come in the morning, I just give a quick introduction. Open Data Day is an annual celebration for open data all over the world. So today we are glad to have 32 participants join this event. So give it up for those all of them. We also want to thank for our volunteers. And there's an open source conference on June 9 to 10. So if you are interested in this kind of event, just go to the website and check it out. And also thanks for our venue sponsor. Okay, I know after 5 hours hacking, how are you? Are you exalted or excited? I think in the attending a hackathon, the best part is you can meet some friends that you have the same interest and you work together to do something. So I think every people is curious about what you have done during these 5 hours. So it's time to team presentations. And which team want to be the first one? Anyone? No, I just.
So a slightly more aggressive team name for us is This Data Kills Fascists. We're not actually going to kill fascists, but following Woody Guthrie's inspiration, we want to kill their arguments using open data. Our team was working on issues. There's a lot of rhetoric and moves in Hong Kong to build big giant refugee camps. Lock people up, spend billions on this because certain politicians say there's a crime wave, increasing crime. But what is this based on? We can't find data. You go in data.gov, .hk, nothing in there. So sometimes you have to find your own data, doing spamming all of the police forces with access info requests. Using the Access Info portal, have the data stored in lots of disparate, weird PDFs and in lots of different ways. It's very inconsistent, talking about calling refugees lots of different things. Some districts gave loads and loads of different data, even down to nationality. Some districts said they don't even have data. So I've been collecting this data for a while. One example, a politician in Shamshu Po says there's a big problem with specifically South Asians causing crime in Shamshu Po, and it's terrible. We need to, there's huge amounts of crime. So actually I got this data from Shamshu Po, and it shows there was about 2% of the crime is caused by South Asians. He wanted to lock them all up, so if you did that, you'd potentially stop about 30 crimes, and you probably have to spend about 10 billion Hong Kong dollars to do that. So you can do policy making based on this. But we had lots of gaps, trying to figure out what to do with this data. It's in PDFs and lots of forms, so our team, we spent the day filling some of these gaps, did some more access info requests. We were kind of looking for lots of other data sources, government press releases, the Hong Kong Legal Information Institute database and judiciary database. There's huge amounts of stuff that could be data mined in there, although that's going to be quite a bit of work. Other government departments, we were looking at census data to normalize this too. And Robert and the team, then of some of the data we had, he was just trying to visualize it with R and Shiny. Some of the data that we got, we've already liberated data, putting it in our CCAN install some of the census data on ethnicity. Robert, I'll tweet the shiny link. He's done some interactive visualizations and views of some of the crime statistics over all of the police regions, for example, and also a breakdown on one region. We've got very good data over the different districts for refugee crime and non-refugee crime. And is this a big? Are we being swamped? Is crime going up? Well, it's pretty flat, and it's like refugee crime is really, really tiny. So you have to decide whether you're willing to spend $10 billion to address that. And have an appendix of lots of the data sources and stuff that we collected, and I can stick that up on the Hackpad. So that's what we did.
Do anybody want to say something to him? Is it? Or any questions? Okay.
Wait, are refugees causing crime? Are they? How much crime are they committing?
2% in Shemshi Po.
Is that too much? That's even 2% is too much.
Thank you. Wait. Come to find me. Okay. And next one?
I guess most of you were here this morning, so I will introduce but very briefly the project. It was about water pollution monitoring in China, in mainland China. And, well, we have access to some data in terms of the pollution at different places in China, and we were wondering what to do with it. The conclusion we had was that 5 hours is way too short to come with an answer, but we tried different approaches, so that's going to be a bit random kind of slides. Xavier is going to talk about the first challenges around the Holy.
Hello, so good to meet you. So I want to introduce something. I didn't work with data because I didn't, on my side, gather data on the water quality in China. But what appeared very clearly, very fast actually, in the research on the internet is that there is clearly a problem of data sourcing first. So I want to talk about that. I share in two parts, so I will be very quick. There is one part is about the data collection, and the second part is the data itself once you collected. That is, what is the data you have gathered and what you have got from the official site on the Chinese government site websites. So first thing I tried is to check on the Google Trend, what is interest and what is the number of search you can find about water quality, water pollution, sorry, the term was water pollution, and basically you can see that the number of search is around constant and some spikes, downward spikes, you don't know why, so suddenly people lose total interest with searching for water pollution. But when you look at the map on the right, you can see that you have everything blue and if you really look, most of the countries are actually all English speaking, and except maybe, I don't know what, maybe this is Costa Rica, no, not, I don't know, the South America one, and Mexico of course is not English speaking. But you can see there's an obvious bias with English speaking countries. So we can discard that, in deal. So this is the number of search in Hong Kong. Okay, so we could say, this search is made in with Chinese characters for water pollution, so the same, but in Chinese. So we have this from Hong Kong. So that's not the right that's not the right slide actually. Attends, wait. Ah gosh. Bon, okay, too bad. You can see something. I did the search for Hong Kong and I did the search for China, but it has disappeared. The slide is not here anymore. Basically, the conclusion is that data is not significative, essentially because the numbers of Hong Kong are much higher than from China. And on top of that, you can see on the right of the graph, you have a very big spike with actually our own search today, because we are in March and we did that. So I'm trying to get very fast. So basically what you need to do is to go on Baidu, because of course in China you don't have access to Google, so everybody searching for water pollution is going on Baidu. And this is data we should have used, of course. But just to stress out that we have to be careful on how to get the data right. After that, some slide about the data quality. So there was an article published about the quality of data. Basically, you realize that there are three governmental bodies that issue information about water pollution in China, and they don't even agree. So, because the first one, which is the Ministry of Water Resources, says that 85% of groundwater sources are okay, but the other one says that 60% and more are actually not good. So that's a problem. So before we do any stats and fancy graphs, so we should really check what we are working with. Basically, so I just remind what we should have as the current data, and what we could do when we have noisy data. Normally, you have statistical procedures. I just give an example for fun about the Kalman filter, for example, but there are many of them. But in this case, we don't have that. So what can we do? We can treat, either we can just ignore a bunch of data, like from one body is not correct. From another one, we can just gather more data. That's what is done with a crowdfunding project, actually, IPE. We could also try to reconcile, to find a mixed model. We reconcile the hard properties that we are observing and the statistics we have on it. My response is to say that data and the quality of data is one thing, but it also depends on which model you apply on it. What is the sensitivity of your model to the data? Of course, if you have a very big error on the data, or very uncertainty on the data, if your model is not sensitive to your data, it's okay. So you don't need to work on that. Sorry for being so long. Next one.
Can you click on?
I have to click on the layer.
So basically, like, since we had so many problems with data, it was very surprising to find actually good sources on pages that, at first glance, are not related to. To science. What we actually did, we wanted to know how water pollution affects the animal world. So we started searching first the news on mass deaths of animals. So it's massive deaths. And the interesting thing is that we found that the source that is compiling all the news is related to the Bible, but the relation is also quite different. So it was quite fun to see. But what they do actually, they search data in local news, because what we also found out is that there was a huge interest from international media like New York Times, The Guardian, and the others, when, if you remember, probably like finding all these dead pigs in the rivers, in the Chinese rivers, or 10,000 feet like fish in like in other rivers. But that was, everything was in 2013, and then there was absolutely no attention to what was happening. And what we found out through that source, it's actually happening, and it's happening now. It's happening this year. There were 25 reported cases last year in 2016, and we tried to map them. So it should be appearing soon. So it's basically what we did to see which regions had reports, media reports in local Chinese media. And like the numbers would be like tons of fish, you know, or 10,000, or like 10, like 1,000 of swans found dead in lakes. So probably it's a work for the future to see if it's correlated with, like, if it's, you know, if it's the cause, if water pollution is the cause. But that's also interesting to see. And then there was also another point, like also to see how many sicknesses there are. Okay, so yeah, basically what we are supposed to see is the map and yeah, the cases and the years. But yeah, it's quite interesting because it was also the source that we didn't expect to see, because as it was previously mentioned, the governmental data doesn't have any reports on massive deaths of animals.
I don't think we need to be very lengthy about it, but we just, since pollution is of course something that nobody wants to talk about, you hit this limit of like what you can do with data, because first of all, it's about data collection, right? So we thought that maybe it would be useful to think of open data friends, enemies, and frenemies, and kind of like come up with a set of criteria of what we experienced during the day that we found useful and not useful, and distinguish good practices from like unusual and unhelpful practices. So yeah, I mean, that is, I think, something that as the open data community we can consider further. Like, it's not just only working with data that comes from the government, but we also need data from corporations and from NGOs. And I think it comes down to an argument about, okay, if the rivers, for instance, are part of the commons, then aren't we also supposed to have access to the data about our commons, right? So maybe there was one interesting example of Nike as a corporation actually, after a lot of pressure, of course, being more friendly to open data approaches. So maybe you know more about that. So maybe you want to add something, or?
Yeah, I mean, it's true. When you look at water issues and corporates, the issues that corporations do not disclose where the factories are, and this is very important for water issues, as opposed to carbon issues, where you don't actually need to know where they are. The carbon is the same everywhere, whilst water issues are very location dependent. We mentioned a few sources that are doing well and a few that are not doing well. In terms of, so this is Chinese government, MEP, Ministry of Environmental Protection website. So they are, China is, I mean, mainland China is having a huge transparency movement. It may not be as good as some Western countries, but this is definitely improving. And so these are monitoring stations in China by the Ministry of Environmental Protection that disclose weekly information in terms of water quality. So we got this data from, actually, we got data from other sources, but this data is available. We didn't have time to scrap everything. And once you collect this data, you can geolocalize them. All the dots you see are monitoring stations on the Yellow River, which we gathered previously and today. And then what we wanted to do is, so once you get these data, point, location, water quality, you want to interpolate to get more surface information as opposed to just point information, which might be more useful for benchmarking or depending on where your assets are for companies. So we did, I'm using a interpolation for those that are interested in that, geospatial interpolation package in R that uses you the top creeping interpolation to account basically for the structure of the river network. And this is what we got today, finally. So we took a year of data and we interpolate this using the geospatial analysis, and then we just make a GIF out of it. So this is a year, and we can't see any trend, so that's a bit disappointing, but it's just a year and monthly data. But if you look weekly at weekly data, you can see more cyclical things. But anyway, that's what we did today, very different approaches. Yes. So that was wrong.
Next one. Could you?
Hello guys. So today our teammate have done a project which is about traffic accidents in Hong Kong. So indeed there's a lot of open data from the government or from the official transportation department. So we have to do some hacking ourselves. So in here, one of our approach is to grab the test from the local news, which is the instant news from 903.com. And then after that, as you can see, so the data is very simple. So on the left-hand side, so it has the category and then separated by colon, and then a very brief discussion to describe which place was the accident happening. And then, so at the right-hand side, you see the minutes and hour timestamp, and then so it has a latest status, like for example, whether the wall is being cleaned or not, whether is there an update or delay or not. So lastly, we have a date at the white column. So after we do, after we have done so much data cleansing, and then, wait a second. Okay, so here is the data we downloaded from all the HTML download from the news website this morning, and then it takes around 100 hours, around 1 hour. Even my program is in single thread. So as you can see, the HTML content is like this. So after we collect all the HTML, around 4,000 HTMLs, which consists of 7 years data, and then. And then under some data cleansing, and then we have the sorry, it's a little bit slow. And let's go to the data. So meanwhile, I will just talk about what have we done this afternoon. So after we get the data from the internet, we just pass it from HTML to CSV. So here, we obtain some information such as time, such as a place, so such as the status. And then after we get all this information, we do a further data joining that we get the GPS coordinate from the Google Geocoder, so that we also obtain latitude and longitude of that incident. So after that, we can plot this. So the way one saw it, so in that there are so many car accidents or blocking in the last 7 years. So while the green one would just showing that there were less accidents. So as you can see. So I think everyone knows that even without this graph that most traffic accidents occur in Kowloon or either Hong Kong Island. So when you're talking about the human, there are also some accidents happening also often. But as you can see, if you're going into the Hong Kong Island, so there are some area which are really impacted by the accident, such as the Wan Chai or Tin Ho, Causeway Bay or Tin Ho, and then we also have the Central and Wan Chai. And in the Kowloon side, there are also accidents in Tsim Sha Tsui and the Prince Edward or Mong Kok, and also in Chang Kwan O. So another simple plotting is done. So and apparently it's just like random data, but if we look at the data or graph more carefully, we may find that every February would be a local minimum. I don't know why. And somehow in the summer there are much more accidents. So I have two theories and here. The theory number A is which I just said is the car accidents would have some seasonality character. So in winter we may have less car accidents, and in summer there are more people driving, so there are more accidents. So and theory B number two or B is that so my program simply has some but. So I don't know.
Chinese New Year.
Yeah. So I don't know why every year in every October there are less traffic accidents. Maybe possible
Autumn
that's
festival and Chinese
yeah.
New Year.
Yeah. And then in summer so for example it's July, so there's a local maximum amount in that particular year. So somehow there is a pattern in the frequency of the traffic accident. Okay. I will let my teammate Ben to present.
Hey, by the way, I have a question. Have you ever tried to dissect or to group those numbers in respect of the days of a week? Say
that's a very good question. I was trying to do that, but I just don't have enough time. So
all right. Because
that would be another interesting problem I would like to explore.
We always blame the Sunday drivers, so.
My teammate has some other graphs to present. I will just pass it to him.
Thank you very much. Here I just want to share two charts with you to reply to the previous question. I put a chart that by hour. You can see that the peak hours are 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. and not to your surprise because this is the daytime. And okay, and other chart is that yes, this is number of instance by month, and the peak months are in summer. Okay, and the top 5% of incident type, the top one is traffic accident, and the second one is breakdown of vehicle. The percentage of the top one traffic accident is over 65%. Thank you very much.
Thanks for sharing. So now we know we have to be careful when we get someplace. And then next one.
Thank you.
Yeah, some technical problems. Hi, I'm Brian, and this is Jason and Horace. And in Taiwan, there are a lot of societies, like more than 38,000, like what the Mui Hui Association, different types of societies, which usually we know what are they doing and where are them. And there are lots of like scandals, like they are planning for elections and a lot of mystery things from them. But luckily in police.government.hk there is a list for all the societies registered in Hong Kong. But unfortunately this is a PDF file with watermark. So we have to do something in order to explore this data and see if there's any interesting things inside. And as you can see, there is only three columns, code, name, and address for each society. And usually the address comprises of usually Chinese or English, and the names, sometimes they have English names or Chinese names. And what we do is try to split and classify those names and address to Chinese and English. And for the address, we use some other methods to retrieve the location, the region, the district, and add some attributes to explore these data. Yep, and Jason will talk about some technical things.
Okay, just a hint for the community. Actually, PHP and MySQL or Python has a very good tools to break down the characters and analyze the raw text. And also we do some magic that teach the computer from single Chinese character to learn phrases or words so that it can generate some meaningful result.
Okay. And first we have done a simple web cloud for the prefix and some terms. And for example, usually they use, for example, association and sports and or teachers association or some drama things or some concern groups. And for the types, usually for sports culture and some Tai Chi or some concern group again. And these are the frequent wordings. And for the English, it's rather simple, like Hong Kong Club Society, Chinese, opera, a lot of different interesting things. But what we concern is for the Chinese. Usually, we have some doubts that a lot of societies are from Chinese. Are China related? They may be the satellite communities from the China. So we have done a little data exploration for that. And around 6% of the societies are related to China. How did we come out with these statistics? We use some terms like Chinese China, in Chinese Zhonghua, Zhongguo, or any kind of related terms. And then we try to sort out those associations. And we found out among the 38,000 societies, there are around 6% is related to China, but it doesn't mean anything. But we have five other interesting things.
Thank you. And I'm Horace. I'm going to continue to our findings in the Chinese societies. And we have investigated which region Chinese province which societies belongs to. And I visualize in the Google Map, and you can see that. Let me open it. We have the details, and you can see. Oops, sorry. Okay, the first of all, you can see the T Jigong and Zhejiang. There is a distribute in here in a Kowloon somewhere. And sorry. And then the Guangdong, you can see it's many societies in new territories and Kowloon and even the Hong Kong district. And Hunan and some about it in Thai islands. Okay, and Guangxi, and there is evenly distributed in Hong Kong. But the Fujian is many of them is in the Chunwan and the Chengyi and the Hong Kong line is the NTR station and you can find them here. And the last one, the Beijing, is more in the Hong Kong and Hong Kong and something else, somewhere else. So this is the, here is the big picture, oh sorry. Okay, so you have had the big picture in the one chart. So I think you might be bored, so I just keep the fun. The screen is...
Yeah, this kind of simple name generator that generates a lot of names, and as their names are usually similar, and people can recognize it.
Okay,
and this...
Zoom out.
Yeah, usually these things can make some people to maybe they will be interested in this issue by getting these slot machines.
Full screen.
You just press this one button and generate the society name automatically. Just for fun. Okay, and furtherly, we want to build a relational map to see whether the relationship between the societies based on their similarity or their natures of the society, and visualize their location. Maybe use a traffic data plots in the map, just like these examples. And in the future, we would like to build a database with more information and with more data attributes like the establishment date and nature and the location and the number of members, and integrate the data with other data sets such as the voter information. As you know, we can know how the society is important to the voting process. And further analysis, when we have the data address, and we can know how they share the same location, we can identify we have a close relationship between these societies, and to build a relation map I have mentioned, and how long the societies can survive, and what is the life cycle, or which type of the societies, maybe music or some other interest, suddenly may establish in several duration. So we would like to investigate such information, and also, and more further, the data we would like to have. Once we have the data, and we can be a smart city, because we can input the, and we can tell the machines to learn your society name, what is valid or not, and even you can replace the jobs of the Hong Kong police. They don't need to audit your name, and also another process. And finally, that if we have the data of the citizen preference, and we can recommend or some societies to them, and to be more smart in this process. And that's all our presentation. Thank you.
I think we have two more teams, right? There and there. Who you want to be first? Okay, lady first.
Thank you.
Hi everybody, I'm Yiming, and this is Luna, and this is Yuqiong. So we are presenting something we did this today, which is analyzing Trump's tweets. So speaking of Trump, he is more or less man of the year, and with an attitude to accompany it. So there is a saying, mainly among like mainland Chinese students, I don't know if Hong Kong students also like to say this, we say that he is ruling via Twitter, that is, Trump won the election via Twitter, and he tries to influence the population's attitude about certain things, towards certain things via Twitter. So what do Trump's tweets say about him? We kind of find this data set called Trump Twitter Archive, which is drawn from like obviously Twitter by some guy. And so the data set is from like this. So for each kind of Twitter from like 2009 something to this January, we have the favorite counts and the source, whether he tweets from the web or from Android devices or from iPhone. And also he has a text, which is blah, blah, blah. And also he may be, this tweet may be in reply to somebody. And whether it is retweeted, obviously this tweet is not very popular, so nobody retweeted it. And the created ad is the time he tweet. And we also have the retweet count for the tweets that were retweeted. So we have 30,000 something tweets from Donald Trump from 2009 to January 2017. And we also have 11,000 something tweets from Ivanka from 2009 to 2017. So the data cleaning is done in R. So first we retrieve all the hashtags, the URLs, which is HTTP something or www something. And also the Twitter accounts he mentioned, for example, at himself or at Ivanka or other people. So we first extract everything from all of his tweets. And next we did something simple because we have limited time. We lowercase everything and also strip the white spaces and punctuations. And so all the tweets removing the stuff we did remove from the last step. We back the tweets into a term document matrix. And today we did not perform any stemming because the Wi-Fi is not very good, and I cannot download the R library for stemming. So here are some fun facts. These are the top 5 used hashtags by Donald Trump. So, do you want to guess which one is the most used?
Trump.
Okay, somebody said Trump, and somebody thinks make America great again. And I hear someone said the correct answer, which is his campaign, obviously. So he like used this hashtag for like 907 times. And coming up next is make America great again. The other two are more or less the same. So, but they together combined are not greater than make America great again. And he did not tweet his own surname very much, which is kind of unexpected. And here are the top 5 used hashtags by Ivanka. So again, you want to guess which is mostly used?
Woman to work.
Wise work.
That guy is correct. Women who work. And she tweeted it really a lot. And coming up next is some advice and entrepreneur stuff and other wise words and life hack. And obviously Ivanka really likes giving other people like advice or showing her own opinion. And So most mentioned Twitter account by Donald Trump is himself. he added himself for 8,453 times. Okay, I don't use Twitter that much, and when I use Twitter, I never add myself. I don't know, maybe he would like more people to follow him. And coming up next is Obama. And you think that he would mention his daughter or other like Fox News or other stuff much, but he likes Obama quite a lot. And he, not necessarily likes him a lot, maybe hates him a lot, so he tweeted, he added him a lot. And other people, Ivanka only has 194 tweets, and his enemy only has 71. So maybe he thinks Obama is like more dangerous for his campaign than Clinton and all the stuff. So here is the order of tweet VIPs for D. Trump. So Donald Trump is much larger than Obama, is much larger than his daughter, and is much larger than Clinton. So obviously he likes, he has a strong feeling towards Obama, and Obama is like, what? So now we have more analysis, which I passed the presentation to
Hi, so after we got the Trump document matrix, we done a little bit like a workload using the R package, just called workload, and here's one for Trump. It's kind of surprising, right? Because such a narcissistic person, you think. I think the most frequent word is actually great. Probably that's because he says make America great again quite a lot. And also the thank, I guess that's probably, I don't know, a way to interact with his friends, and also, unsurprisingly, the Trump and also president. Right. I think we have the top 200 most frequent words here, and this is the workload for his daughter. Right, so first tips, just like please do our first finding that this is a woman that likes to give advice a lot, using tips and new and things. Right.
So you didn't see him tweeting about China a lot, but he talks about China a lot. So let's see how we did some data visualization. This is how Trump's tweet related to China. We analyzed China, Chinese, China's, a lot of China-related tweets. So basically, you can see from the chart above, that is actually the velocity of his tweets, but you can see there's some space below some of the years. That means we minus those tweets from iPhone, because there's rumors that some tweets from iPhone are not tweeted by Trump himself. So actually he only tweeted about China, not that much as we expected. And the below chart is a comparison between Trump and his daughter tweeting about different countries. So you can see that Ivanka never mentioned Russia. And actually, Trump tweeted about Russia more than China. And the only and Ivanka even tweeted about using Chinese, means Happy New Year.
To wrap it up, so for future work, you could perform more visualization, and also you could do some more complicated stuff, like sentiment analysis from Trump's tweets. And also you could try to distinguish between Donald's and Ivanka's tweets. Like first we try to use the SJ metric between the documents of tweets, and then we could fit the classifier and stuff. We could do machine learning. And also, Yu-Chun would really like to create a chatbot. It can also talk like Trump. Like today, if you have a chatbot, he would say, like, make open data great again. Okay. But I don't really like Trump. I hope, okay. I hope you're not offended by me quoting Trump. That's all. Thank you. Anything else? Yeah, sure. If you have an API and stuff, you could like crawl down all the tweets and do the Chinese. Maybe the sentiment analysis part is will be more difficult because Chinese grammar is like more complicated.
Well, thanks. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks for such an interesting project. And then our last one.
Hi. So last speaker is very stressed because I'm a boring person and presenting a very boring project. So I hope that you can have a good night's sleep tonight. And as I've mentioned this morning, our team has scraped all the press release from the government, and it takes a lot of time because we don't want to doom the government server, and so we did it slowly, and after the scraping we get 47,000, close to 48,000 press release from the government, and actually the data is a CSV, so we can do some interesting analysis about that data set. And for example, this one is the content of the press release. As you can see, it's just some text, Chinese text, and because this is a CSV, so we can use some standard R. Okay, I'm R person. I can just use some standard R analysis routine to, for example, count how many of the content contain the word chief executive in Chinese, and then I've created a program to query such a corpus of all the press release, and for example this one is just a general churn, and the these spikes are the actual counts, and that one is the smooth trend. So and you can see that, okay, the government have a typical summer dip every summer. So, yeah. And the next thing is something that we can clearly see the seasonal trend, which is flu. For example, this one we query the corpus about flu, and we can see the peaks of flu in each year. Okay, and what more. For example, our chief executive. So again, he's similar to the government, actually. He also have a summer dip. But 2014, he's kind of busy. And I will show you why. And the next two is showing how our memory works. For example, the problem of Qingjin. After the first two waves, and then we basically forget everything about it. And then that one. Similarly, we have one peak and then we forget about that. And then the next one is 最衰都係佔中係。 And we can clearly see a peak about Occupy in the late 2014. And this one is for our mother. And as you can see that there is also a surge in the number of press release about our mother in the late 2014. And then this one. Zheng Chongtai has gone, so we can see that actually only the government talking about it. And then what else? This one. This one is also showing how our memory works. Okay. And after the waiting for Uncle Fat here, and we basically forget about anything about the political reform. And okay, today is the open day of day. So we can actually and then again this one is how we have how the government creates some memory for us. So this one is about One Belt, One Road. And actually before 2015, nobody know what it is. And then the government published a lot of press release about it, which all of us are not quite interested in.
Hong Kong TV.
And this one is Hong Kong TV. And similarly, we can see some peaks, but I don't want to query this one. And finally, this one is the signature CY Leung speech. And it's quite consistent. And again, here. Again, it's 最衰都係佔中. And this one is the final one. So, similarly, we can see a peak after the Occupy. And I can entertain one query, any three keywords you want to know. Give me one keyword.
林鄭月娥. So the current CS run,
she has decreased in popularity.
But do you have data of this year?
Not yet. One more. Okay. Yeah, it's basically the election cycle. So, yeah, and I will pass it to Willie. I will pass it to my colleagues and he will show us some interesting visualization.
Similarly, we select about 100 keywords and can't have the frequency similar. What has shown? We try to rank by the frequency. So most frequent keywords fund is a housing and university and so on. And we do some visualization, workout. So, then you can see. So the bigger the word, the higher frequency they appear in the class. Each year, we will have a different
I have it.
CY managed quite a lot words about love, but we didn't look at the detail,
love.
So we are not sure what it actually means.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so today everyone finished presentation, so really thanks for coming here and hope you enjoy today. So see you next year.